please welcome ECC Executive Board Member Travis Shear.
Good morning. Our business continues to grow more complex. Our projects are larger in capacity and value, and we face constraints in people power throughout our value chains. There are many new factors that influence our business in ways that we may not yet fully understand. To help us understand some of these challenges in a different way, we are fortunate to have Dr. Anirban Basu here today. Dr. Anirban Basu is chairman and CEO of Sage, an economic and policy consulting firm in Baltimore that he founded in 2004. Dr. Basu is among the most recognizable economists, in part because of his consulting work on behalf of numerous clients, including prominent developers, bankers, brokerage houses, energy suppliers, law firms, and business associations. Dr. Basu has written several high-profile economic development strategies on behalf of government agencies and nonprofit organizations, including co-authoring economic development strategies for Baltimore City and Baltimore County. Among other things, Dr. Basu serves as the chief economist to the Associated Builders and Contractors and as chief economic advisor to the Construction Financial Management Association. Dr. Basu earned his BS in Foreign Service at Georgetown University. He earned his Master's in Public Policy from Harvard University's John F. Kennedy School of Government and his Master's in Economics from the University of Maryland. His JD was earned at the University of Maryland Law School in 2003, and he completed his PhD in Health Economics at UMBC in 2020. With that, I'd like to give a warm ECC welcome to Dr. Basu.
Thank you. Here you go. All right, nice. Righto, yes, good morning. My name is Anirban Basu. I'm an economist. Please hold any further applause. And I've been asked to talk to you about the economy and what it means for construction and other aspects of economic life. A privilege to be with you. I will have actually some time at the end of this to entertain your questions coming through the app. My presentation today is entitled Show Me the Money Supply. This is a Tom Cruise themed presentation. You'll see that theming throughout the presentation, whether you like it or not. I hope you don't hate it. It's firmly baked within the cake. This is him from the 1996 hit movie Jerry Maguire, in which he plays the role of a sports agent with a single client, the fictitious Arizona Cardinals wide receiver Rod Tidwell, played by the actor Cuba Gooding Jr. In any case, you'll see those references, but this is not about Tom Cruise. This is about the economy. And the subject of the economy, of course, is vast, and an economist could begin almost anywhere discussing the economy. And so why would an economist begin with the concept of money supply? Well, as it turns out, money supply is at the heart of the matter. When money supply is expanding, when the cost of capital is low, including in the form of low interest rates, when money is easily accessible, including from banks, that's generally speaking good for economic growth, it's good for project financing, it's good for engineering, construction, architects, so on and so forth. However, when money supply is shrinking, when the cost of capital is rising, including in the form of higher interest rates, and when money is becoming more difficult to access, including bank credit, that's generally speaking bad for economic growth and project financing. Much of the data I will show you are time series data, so the more contemporary data are to the right of the slide. Here's money supply graph back to 1959. You can see the profound growth in money supply during the pandemic and the pandemic recovery period, at least the early part of the pandemic recovery period. This is engineered by the Federal Reserve Bank of the United States, which has increased the size of its balance sheet, reducing interest rates as close to zero as was possible to try to induce us to borrow more and spend more, borrow more and invest more. The federal government, for its part, is borrowing aggressively as well, spending money in the economy directly and indirectly. Each of these is acts of money supply creation. Money supply is blossoming. And from the perspective of countervailing the worst periods of the pandemic economically, it absolutely works. By the second quarter of 2021, US gross domestic product is above its pre-pandemic tally. The pandemic undoes the economy during the spring of 2020. A bit more than a year later, we are back along that dimension. Unfortunately, that V-shaped, very rapid recovery brings with it an enduring bout of inflation. The Federal Reserve has spent the last year and a half, roughly, trying to countervail that by raising interest rates, shrinking the size of its balance sheet. Money supply has been shrinking, and when money supply is shrinking, when the cost of capital is rising and when money becomes more difficult to access, that can produce some pretty risky business. And that's what we want to talk about today, some of the risks inherent in the economy. Because it's been a splendid recovery, hasn't it been? Surprisingly strong and surprisingly durable. We'll talk about that. Now, what's the culprit here? Why have we shifted the discussion potentially from talking about very rapid economic recovery from the early stages of the pandemic economically to talking now about, let's say, the risk of recession in the next 12 months, if not sooner than that? Well, of course, the culprit is inflation. This is your consumer price index, 12-month percentage change. Two lines here. The line in green is your overall consumer price index. And that indicates that over the past 12 months through July of 2023, inflation running at around 3.2%. Now, a lot of decline in inflation, and inflation has declined. The Federal Reserve can claim some victory here, can't it? Because in June of 2022, inflation is running at 9% year over year, now 3.2%. But a lot of that has been due to reductions in oil and food prices. Energy and food prices generally. So you might remember after the outbreak of hostilities in Ukraine, oil prices briefly were above $120 a barrel. As I got up here to speak, oil prices slightly below $83 a barrel, despite the fact that the storm coming through Florida and other places has helped to raise the price of oil by around $3 a barrel in recent days. Food prices have also shrunk in many cases. Another source of deflation or disinflation. I'll give you an example, egg prices. I don't know how many of you have become engrossed in a conversation about egg prices at some point this year, often with neighbors. I find that they're very difficult to extract oneself from such conversations. Very early this year, I delivered a presentation at the University of Delaware. As you know, the University of Delaware gave us the greatest quarterback in NFL history, Joe Flacco. But also, their team name is the Blue Hens. And I looked those blue hens right in the face, and I said, you blue hens should be raising chickens, because egg prices were high at that time. They also did not laugh at that. But the point is that egg prices have come down about 77% from that 2022 peak. But that means if you strip out the food and energy prices, which again have been a source of major deflation or disinflation recently, you get a different measure of inflation called the core rate of inflation, all items less food and energy. That's that other line in bronze here. And that suggests inflation is running at a heavier 4.7%. And in either case, these rates of inflation are above the Federal Reserve's 2% target. So the war on inflation is yet to be won. Now, we economists have this bad habit of talking about inflation in the context of Federal Reserve policymaking and interest rates. But of course, there are many broader effects here, including impact in the cost of construction, but also waylaying household balance sheets. So if you look at where price levels were in May of 2020, why that month, that was the first month of the economic recovery. So America loses 22 million jobs in March and April of 2020. We start to add back jobs in May of 2020. So if you look at price levels as they were in May of 2020 and compare that to July of 2023, the last month for which we have data, if you look toward the bottom, you can see the headline numbers. In about 3 years, overall inflation running at 19.2%. Strip out food and energy prices, still a heavy 16.4%. In a country that aspires to 2% inflation per annum, if you look at the green color bars here, categorically, energy prices up 56%, used car and truck prices up 46%, transportation station services, that includes things like your airfare, is up 33%, tobacco and smoking product prices up 24%, new vehicle product prices up 22%. So one of the worst things you can do is smoke in a new car, because that's bad for your health, it destroys new car smell, but also renders one susceptible to some of this inflation. Now again, inflation has dissipated over the past 12 months. So if I show you the same data series, but instead of comparing May of 2020 against July of 2023, just looking at July of 22, July of last year against July of 2023, a 1 year or 12 month percentage change here, again, the headline numbers down before previously quoted, 3.2% overall inflation, 4.7% on the core. But if you look at the green color bars, you still see some chunky rates of inflation. Transportation service, again, things like airfares, up around 9%, shelter up 8%, food up 5%. And who does that affect the most? People at the lowest quintiles of income. people for whom food and shelter comprises a disproportionate share of their household budgets. So how does the Federal Reserve reckon with this? Well, they turn to their principal policy instrument, the Federal Reserve's Fed funds rate, the overnight bank lending rate. This is not a rate set by the free market. This is a rate set by the Federal Reserve at its Federal Open Market Committee meetings. Now, when excess inflation burst forth during the spring of 2021, the Federal Reserve responds by doing precisely nothing about it. They deem at that point inflation to be transitory. They think it's purely supply chain driven. We'll come back to supply chains later on in the presentation, I hope. They think, my goodness, demand is surging coming out of the early stages of the pandemic as the economy reopens and fits and starts. But supply chains have been shuttered to varying degrees. Demand exceeded supply. That's inflationary. But as supply chains healed, as they normalized, supply would rise up to meet demand, that excess demand would go away, inflation would return to 2%, which is where it had been for many, many years in America. Instead, what the Federal Reserve appears to have done is presided over the creation of a wage price spiral. So prices take off during the spring of 2021. Employees notice. Boss, do you look at the, can you see the consumer price index data? Prices are rising very, very quickly. I need a raise. Boss says, no problem. The economy's coming back very, very quickly. There's lots of unmet demand out there. I need you in this recovery period. Here's your raise. I'll just pass along my cost increases to my customers, which I'm more likely to be able to do in an inflationary environment. Indeed, corporate profits are positively correlated with inflation. You can sort of inject more margin into one's pricing. But of course, that triggers another bout of wage inflation, which again triggers another bout of economy-wide inflation. Starting on March 16th of last year, the Federal Reserve wakes up and says, let's start raising interest rates. But even then, even after roughly a year of excess inflation, they only dip their toes in the inflation-fighting waters. On that day, raising interest rates 0.25%. Next meeting, 0.5%. Then four consecutive meetings of 0.75%, back to 0.5%, then 0.25%, 0.25%, May 3rd of this year, 0.25%, pause in June, July 26th, 0.25%, next meeting's in September. So an interest rate that was 0.25% is now 5.50%. That's a big deal. And the Federal Reserve ostensibly is not trying to destroy the economy, they're trying to engineer a soft landing. What does that mean? They want to slow down economic growth by raising the cost of borrowing, thereby reducing aggregate demand, bringing supply into conformance with demand, get inflation down to 2% without driving us into recession. And the question becomes at this point in the economic cycle, is it possible for them to engineer that soft landing, or is it mission impossible? That really is the question. And I gotta tell you right now, again, another area in which the Federal Reserve can claim victory, the economy is not in recession right now. But here's the thing. Monetary policy operates with a lag. So I won't go through all of this, but if you can see the first bullet there, it says, and this is a quote from the president and CEO of the Federal Reserve Bank of Atlanta, the very well-respected, highly regarded Raphael Bostic, quote, a large body of research tells us it can take 18 months to 2 years or more for tighter monetary policy to materially affect inflation. Well, the Federal Reserve only started raising rates March 16th of last year. About a year and a half ago. We have yet to see the full effect of that. I said, no, Anirban, you're wrong. Inflation's come down from 9% to 3%. You said that yourself. But why is that? That's because of improving supply chains. That's my judgment. When you have improving supply chains in the context of unmet demand, what happens? As supply rises up, you get more transactional volume to meet that unmet demand. That's economic growth. But at the same time, when you have less scarcity, when now goods become more available and services, that's also deflationary, disinflationary. So you can, as supply chains improve, you get the best of both worlds, faster economic growth, less inflation. But my view is that the monetary impacts, the impacts of monetary policy, have yet to be fully felt by the economy. And we'll talk more about this as I go to the forecast part of the presentation. But again, it is absolutely true that despite all these rate increases, thus far the economy has avoided recession. The broadest indication of U.S. economic progress is gross domestic product, or growth therein. If you look from the left of the slide, you can see the undoing of the economy during the first half of 2020, but then the V-shaped recovery. So after a negative 29.9% performance during the second quarter of 2020, the 35.3% positive growth during the third quarter, several ensuing quarters of high single-digit rates of growth in an economy accustomed to growing 1.5% to 3% per annum. True, During the first half of 2022, America suffers a setback. Two consecutive quarters of negative real GDP growth, satisfying a technical definition of recession, but then the bounce back during the second half of last year, 3.2% during the third quarter, 2.6% to complete the year. 2.0% was the growth rate during the first quarter of this year. We just got revised data yesterday for the second quarter, revised downward to 2.1%, but none of these are indicia of recession. We are now a bit more than halfway through the third quarter. The Atlanta Federal Reserve maintains a product known as GDP Now, which estimates current quarter gross domestic product growth. And as of 8/24, the outlook was that for this quarter, we're on pace to grow 5.9% on an annualized basis. So interest rates have gone up, inflation's come down, and economic growth appears to be accelerating. Again, the Federal Reserve can claim victory. And a lot of economists, by the way, have dropped their recession projections or predictions for this year, including economists at Bank of America and JP Morgan. And there are certain parts of the economy that have been especially strong. And one of those is the American consumer. This is retail sales. The consumer is still spending. You can see it. Many of you were at airports, you know, in the last few days. You saw how lengthy the TSA lines are. Now you're a TSA pre-check. I understand that. I understand who I'm speaking to. But nonetheless, you know, the lines are long. Undoubtedly, you've been to various shopping venues and asked yourself, where are all these people getting all this money to spend? I also do not know. But wherever it's coming from, they are spending it. And of course, part of this is the excess savings generated during the pandemic. So at one point, American households enjoyed about $2.7 trillion in excess savings, meaning savings above and beyond what they would have saved but for the pandemic. They didn't take vacations, they got stimulus payments, lots of savings. They've been spending that down. And the San Francisco Federal Reserve believes that by the end of this quarter, I mean, the end of next month, those excess savings will be gone. We just got data today indicating that personal consumption has been quite strong this summer, but personal income growth, once adjusted for inflation, has not been that rapid. But the consumer's really putting it out there. And yes, they're taking on lots of debt. You might have heard that recently credit card debt surged past the $1 trillion mark. I'll show you a graph on that later. But they continue to be supported by a strong job market, and it would seem that as long as the labor market is strong, they can keep spending. This is monthly job growth. Now, the last month for which we have data, July of 2023, a month during which America adds 187,000 jobs. And as I say, I will provide for you my forecast for the economy in a moment, but I want to make it clear to you, the economy has not performed the way I would have expected in many ways. And let me give you an example. If somebody had said to me in February of 2022, February of last year, Anirban, here's what's going to happen. The Russians are going to move on the Ukrainians. That's going to happen. Oil prices will surge. Natural gas prices will surge. Wheat, fertilizer, cooking oil prices will surge. And then the next month, the Federal Reserve will start raising interest rates at the fastest pace in more than four decades. Anirban, what do you think is going to happen with the economy? What do you think is going to happen with unemployment? Now, at that time, March of 2022, the U.S. unemployment rate is 3.6%. I'm skeptical that I would have answered that question by saying, I think the unemployment rate will fall to 3.5%. That's exactly what's happened. And as many people as American employers have collectively hired in recent years, they want to hire even more. According to the Job Openings and Labor Turnover Survey, America presently home to 8.8 million available unfilled jobs. Yes, the number of job openings has been falling. We received data on that earlier this week, but still quite high. Pre-pandemic, when the economy was viewed as very strong, and at that time we had a 50-year low in unemployment, we had about 7 million job openings in this country. There are about 1.5 job openings in this country for every unemployed American. America is still very much a land of opportunity. If you want a job in America, there's one waiting for you. In fact, there's 1.5. And one of the reasons for this is demographic. This is not simply a cyclical issue. This is not simply a function of the fact that the U.S. economy came screaming out of the early stages of the pandemic economically. No, there's a structural issue here. The labor market, or labor force, I should say, is not growing fast enough to accommodate the needs, wants, desires, and aspirations of U.S. economic actors, including American consumers. So here I'm comparing the labor force participation rate, the proportion of eligible people to work who are actually, in fact, working or looking for work, in 1980, when music was good, versus 2023. So 1980, so that would have been Styx, Air Supply, REO Speedwagon, Billy Squire, against 2023. So in America, you have to be at least 16 years of age to be part of the labor force. In Canada, it's 15. Here, it's 16. So you look at the tabular data here, if you can see this, if you look at the top row there, which is also the bolded row, the labor force participation rate between 1980 and 2023, the proportion of people looking for work or working fell 1.2 percentage points. But it falls 9 percentage points for men while rising 6 percentage points for women. So men jumped out of the labor force, women jumped in. Now you can break this down by age. 16 and 19-year-olds, negative 20 percentage points overall, negative 24 percentage points for men, negative 16 percentage points for women. What's that about? That's college attendance. College attendance soars after the 1970s in this country, and if one is attending college, one is less likely to offer their services to the U.S. labor market. 20, 24-year-olds, negative 6 percentage points overall, negative 13 percentage points for men, but positive 1 percentage point for women. What's that about? Well, it could still be college, because it probably takes most guys 6 to 8 years to finish college. But then you look at 25 to 34-year-olds, positive 4 percentage points overall, negative 6 percentage points for men, positive 13 percentage points for young women of that age category, 25 to 34 years of age. What are these young men up to? They are neither working nor looking for work. They live in America. They're neither working nor looking for work. What precisely are they doing? No one really knows because everyone's too scared to ask. But my very strong sense is that it involves a parent's basement, a couch in that parent's basement, maybe some video game play, and maybe, just maybe, some weed. Now, I'm not here to judge. You did not invite me to this conference to judge behavior. I'm not doing that. I'm just simply suggesting to you that the data indicate that this might be happening in large numbers in America, in a large amount. Now, you might say, well, look, you were invited to this ECC conference, Anirban, as an economist to be data-driven, analytical, unemotional. You might say, Anirban, you're getting upset up there. You're getting angry. You're getting emotional. You might say to me further, Anirban, the idea of a 33-year-old American man, you know, in his parents' basement playing video games, getting bologna and salami sandwiches while, you know, smoking some weed, that's adorable. I don't disagree. I think that is adorable. I'm not saying otherwise, but it's less adorable when they're 43. So if you look at 35 to 44-year-olds, positive 4 percentage points are all negative 5 percentage points for men, positive, you can see the 12 percentage points for women. Again, these young men jumping out of the labor force. And for industries that are male-dominated, and there are some, construction, manufacturing, mining, truck driving, this exacerbates the human capital shortfalls. And that's inflationary. And again, the war on inflation is hardly over, and American employers would still love to hire more people. I mean, still 8.8 million available unfilled jobs, despite the fact that we already have record levels of employment in this country. So if you were to compare February of 2020 employment in America, why that month? That's the month before we shut down the economy, versus July of 2023, the last month for TRIV data, America's up almost precisely 4 million jobs. Now, these horizontal bars represent the number of jobs added or subtracted by each of these categories. At the top of the list is professional and business services. That's your accounting firms, your law firms, lots of white-collar jobs allocated to those segments. It's a very large part of the U.S. economy, which helps explain part of its primacy here, but also disproportionately offers the opportunity for people to work remotely. And that's what many people want. They don't want to commute. They don't want to be with their colleagues. They do not like their colleagues. A recent survey indicated that 57% of Americans find their colleagues to be annoying because they overshare, meaning I asked you what you did this weekend, I did not intend for you to answer. They take credit for another's work, but the number one reason people find their colleagues to be annoying, they interrupt during meetings, which can happen on Zoom and typically does. Nonetheless, there's a general preference for remote work. Not coincidentally, at the bottom, leisure and hospitality, that's your hotel and restaurant employee. It's the lowest wage segment of the economy, so often outcompeted for human capital along the dimension of compensation, but also disproportionately does not offer the opportunity for people to work remotely. Now, these issues of labor force challenges, shortages, and therefore the inflationary pressures related to that have been particularly severe in areas that have added more jobs. This is employment growth for the 25 largest metropolitan areas in America. This is for the period February of 2020 versus July of 2023. Notice the primacy of the American South in terms of growth. That's where the population growth has been. That's where the job growth has been. Dallas, Charlotte, Tampa, San Antonio, Orlando, Atlanta, Houston, Riverside, California. That's where it's been. Now, I think in-migration to the South is slowing. Why is that? Part of that is mortgage rates. I'll talk about that later on in the presentation. So, you know, if somebody's sitting, let's say, in Minneapolis or Milwaukee with a 2.75% 30-year fix, they're not going anywhere. They will move when God makes them move. Otherwise, they're right there. They're going to stay right there. They're not going to. And then also, when Phoenix is 115 degrees on a good day, That also probably is the kind of thing that would soften in-migration to the south or out-migration from the north. Now, if you look at the right-hand column, the slower-growing markets, that's the Midwest, Chicago, Minneapolis, Detroit, St. Louis, and also my part of the country, the Northeast Corridor, Philadelphia, as it turns out, sneaks in the left-hand column, the folks who burned on I-95. But then in the right-hand column, it's Boston, New York, Baltimore, and Washington. That's not where the population growth has been as rapid, and therefore the job growth also has not been as rapid. There's an equilibrium there. Now, the next slide is far more important macroeconomically. I find this slide to be interesting, but the next slide is far more important macroeconomically. Same 25 major metropolitan areas, but now this is unemployment rates as of July of 2023. And here's the issue. These unemployment rates are so low, that's inflationary. You can't grow an economy sustainably without triggering excess inflation when there's almost no one left to hire. You always have frictional unemployment. You always have trailing spouses and people graduating from high school, college, apprenticeship programs. You always have some unemployment. But some of these regions have unemployment less than 2% or around 2%. That's inflationary. In August of last year, the Federal Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell delivered a speech indicating that I might have to cause some pain here. Somebody's going to have to lose their job for us to get back to 2% inflation. We still have wage growth in this country between 4 and 5% per annum. To get back down to 2% inflation, you probably need wage growth between 3 and 3.5%. We're not there yet. So interest rates are already high. I know the bond market is suggesting that the chance of another interest rate increase is actually falling today. I get that. Nonetheless, with interest rates already high and inflation not yet cured, that obviously elevates the risk of recession. Again, 1996, Jerry Maguire, I cried. I wept, joyfully, but I wept. So now again, we're not in recession now, but there still might be one in front of us. But before I talk about the likelihood of recession, let me define it for you. I mentioned a moment ago that America sustained those two consecutive quarters of negative real GDP growth during the first half of 2022, satisfying a technical definition of recession, but not the definition. This is the definition. The National Bureau of Economic Research's Business Cycle Dating Committee is the official recession scorekeeper. They're the arbiter of when recessions begin, when they end, if they occurred at all, and accordingly, they're the ones that maintain a chronology of U.S. business cycles. They're the ones, for instance, who told us in 2002 that the recession of 2001 began in March of 2001 and ended in November of 2001. Their traditional definition of recession is, quote, a significant decline in economic activity that has spread across the economy and that lasts more than a few months, except the recession they declared in 2020 begins in February of 2020, ends in April of 2020, arguably not more than a few months. They declared it a recession unless, why? Because they can. They are the definition of recession. If it's a recession to them, it is recession. There is no fixed rule about which indicators contribute information to NBR's process in determining recession. They can look at whatever they please. They can look at the price of Bitcoin if they'd like. Now, as a practical matter, they look at things like industrial production, retail sales, gross domestic product, employment, unemployment, wage growth. But they can look at whatever they please. And because the government statistics NBR relies on are published at various lags, they can't declare a recession until after it begins. So for instance, in March of 2020, we knew recession had begun. Economies opened in February, shut down to varying degrees in March of 2020, but they could not declare a recession because the confirming data had yet to arrive and would not arrive for a couple of months. So again, we're not in recession now, but there are some warning signs. You know, I mentioned that credit card debt has been surging at the household level. And we're starting to see that the expenditures of households vastly exceeds their income growth once you adjust for inflation. So again, recently, credit card debt in this country surpassed the $1 trillion mark. Now, you adjust for inflation, it doesn't look so bad. That's true. Fair enough. Nonetheless, you can see the trajectory here of spending. It does not appear sustainable, especially if you think that the labor market may be softening. Now, there's reason to think the labor market might be softening. This is out of the U.S. gross domestic product data. This is non-residential fixed investment in equipment. And I know we've got some equipment manufacturers here. This is percentage change, 12-month percentage change. I've adjusted these numbers for inflation, so in nominal terms it doesn't look as bad, but this is inflation adjusted. But you can see a real slowing in equipment purchases. And why is that? I think it's because of a shift in CEO attitudes in many instances with respect to how to engage the economy. For much of this pandemic recovery period, the mantra has been, let me chase demand. There's lots of unmet demand out there. If I hire the workers, lease the warehouse space, purchase the equipment, lease the equipment, whatever it happens to be, I expand my capacity to service the marketplace. I win that market share, and in an inflationary environment, I can monetize that market share. Again, corporate profits are positively correlated with inflation. But now more CEOs seem to be taking the attitude that maybe I shouldn't be chasing demand so much. I need to look at the cost side of my business. I've taken a lot of cost. I may have made some bad hires. Maybe I don't need such a large human resources department. I don't need so much administration in any case. I know we've got some folks here from PwC. According to a November 2022 PwC survey of US executives, 26% of firms are planning to reduce the number of full-time employees over the next 12 to 18 months. Now, again, this is late 2022. But again, in the minds of many CEOs, the idea that maybe I need to reduce headcount is there. It was not perhaps there during the early stages of pandemic recovery. In August of 2022, so exactly a year ago, 50% of firms that they already had or had a plan in place to reduce overall headcount. The plans are there. You can see the macroeconomic data, 3.5% unemployment, 8.8 million job openings, 187,000 jobs added in July. We'll get August jobs numbers tomorrow, the initial estimate from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. But so many of these plans have not been actualized. I think we understand that. Nonetheless, the idea is there. 4 to 5 executives served by PwC in November of 2022 said a recession coming within the next 6 months. Now, they're wrong about that. That was said about 10 months ago. There's been no recession. And of course, the third quarter has been very strong economically. Consumers have been spending very aggressively, lots of travel, those kinds of things. Nonetheless, some businesses have seen fit, in fact, to start controlling headcount. Here's some layoffs announced in 2022 and 2023. At the top of the list is Amazon. CEO there is Andy Jassy, of course. Andy Jassy has announced 2 major layoffs, totaling 27,000 jobs. But Andy Jassy did something else. He said to his white-collar workforce, you have to come into the office 3 days a week. That's right. You got to come into work 3 days in 1 week. Are we barbarians? Is this how we treat people? Now, my guess is this was done to foment innovation, supervision, collaboration, but also try to get some people to quit. And some people quit as a result, feeling disrespected by management. Meta, 21,000 layoffs announced there. My slide is a little screwy there, but 21,000 layoffs. So 21,000 is for Amazon. 21,000 for Meta. For Meta, the CEO there, of course, is Mark Zuckerberg. Mark Zuckerberg has declared this year efficiency at Meta. During a recent earnings call, he said the words efficiency or efficient 41 times. Even spending more on the metaverse and artificial intelligence, spending less on administrative functions, and his share price, as you know, has surged this year past 100% growth. So some companies are looking at flipping the script. Instead of chasing growth or chasing demand, now starting to think about the cost side of the industry. And of course, a lot of this is motivated by these higher costs of capital. And those higher costs of capital would tend to impact real estate and construction more aggressively. Let's talk about that now in our final moments together, at least before Q&A. So again, I started this presentation talking about interest rates. I think right place to begin. That's really what's, I think, going to define the trajectory of the economy, some other factors we might talk about in a moment. So here are 2 interest rates of interest. The 30-year fixed mortgage rate is in gold. The 15-year fixed mortgage rate is in green. Green of gold, of course, the color of money, which was a 1986 Tom Cruise film, also starring Paul Newman, playing the part of Fast Eddie Felsen. Now, back in January of 2022, the average 30-year fixed mortgage rate is 3.22%. We just got data from Freddie Mac indicating more than 7%. Now, as I move toward the tail end of this presentation, we'll show you a number of leading economic indicators because we want to pivot from a discussion of what's been going on to a discussion of what's likely to happen, let's say, over the next 12 months. So the home purchasing process often begins with a mortgage application. That's where it begins. So mortgage applications tend to be a leading indicator of home purchases and an indication of how much demand there is for home purchasing opportunities. This is a US mortgage loan application composite index, which is down about 80% since its 2021 peak. And that suggests what? That demand to purchase homes has really dried up. Now, some of you might say, Anirban, that's because of a 7% 30-year fixed mortgage rate? That's not a big deal. My first mortgage rate was 18%. My first mortgage rate was 15%. I've had people come up to me after presentations bragging about the fact that they used to pay 15% on their mortgage. I am not impressed. But it is an interesting history. It is an interesting, and so those folks, 7% will not seem especially onerous, but for millennials and Generation Z, the youngest members of our workforce, the oldest of that group will turn 26 this year, these interest rates are preposterous. And that's just really subtracted themselves from the home purchasing marketplace, that would-be first-time buyer. And you would think, my goodness, with mortgage applications drying up, Anirban, the housing market must be in terrible shape. Home prices must be falling. And of course, they are not. This is the S&P Case-Shiller U.S. National Home Price Index. You can see during the pandemic this phenomenal increase in home prices. People wanted more space, spending more time at home, of course. Wanted space for home offices and home gyms. Kids were coming back from college, needed more bedrooms. And of course, they want to take advantage of the lowest mortgage rates in history. And then as mortgage rates took off, you can see for a period, about 4 months, home prices, home sales prices across the country began to fall, but it didn't last. And now we're back to the peak. The inventory of unsold homes is very low, of course. That's a bit at the heart of this. Many people are buying with cash, and so they're not affected by higher mortgage rates. And so that's where we are. Now, you can break this down by region. So if I look at the S&P Case-Shiller Home Price Index by metropolitan area, this is the 1 month percentage change observed in June. The 0% axis is the left-hand axis. Everywhere, whether it was Cleveland or Los Angeles, we saw home price gains across the country. Every metropolitan area in this index. Again, another way in which the economy has surprised me with its durable strength. And this, of course, impacts construction. This is U.S. residential building permits. It's a leading indicator, because if you're a builder, you've got to pull a permit before you build. You see the gold line there? That's your single-family building permits. And there was a period during which permitting was declining, single-family permitting, but home builder confidence picked up in recent months, though it fell last month. And so they're saying, my goodness, people are still buying, not at the lower end of the market, but at the higher end of the market, which is where margins are greatest anyway. So I can serve that part of the market. Actually, where you see the weakness is the green line, that's multifamily. So anyway, that's impossible. Doesn't make any sense. You just said that the millennials, which is our large generation, parenthetically, is not buying homes right now. They're not applying for mortgages. So they must be living someplace. Must be apartments, right? For the most part, right? So demand for apartments must be high. That's true. So why is multifamily construction, which includes apartment construction, not surging? Oh, I don't think it's because people don't want apartments. I mean, the logic of this is pretty straightforward. You could actually see it in the food industry. You know, if you think about the restaurant chain Checkers, there's a restaurant chain out there known as Checkers. Their slogan for many, many years has been, you gotta eat. That's their slogan, that's their value proposition, you gotta eat. I view that as the worst slogan in the history of U.S. corporate enterprise, because yes, you gotta eat, but not at Checkers. You know, you have so many choices in this country, of course, most importantly, Red Robin. But you know, so now, simply, you have to have a place to live. Yeah, they have to have a place to live. My sense is that permits in the multifamily category are falling, not because of the demand side for apartments, supply side. Developers increasingly having a difficult time lining up financing. Increasingly, banks are reluctant to expose themselves to various risks, including real estate. You might have seen that Moody's and S&P recently downgraded a handful of regional banks, put other banks on the watch list. Among these banks are M&T Bank, so on and so forth. On the watch list now is Truist. Now, same thing with commercial real estate and construction. This is your architectural billings index. Any reading below 50 means that architects are less busy now than they were the previous month. And for 7 of the past 9 months, the reading has been at 50 or less. Architects are getting less busy. Why is that? Well, part of it is because lining up project financing, at least in certain categories of endeavors, is becoming more difficult. And of course, some of these real estate categories are underperforming, like the US office market. This economy grew 2.1% last year, added hundreds of thousands of jobs in traditionally office space using categories, but the office vacancy rate went up, end of the year at 12.5%. But that's a lie. A lot more space than 12.5% is vacant, but it's not deemed to be vacant because it's still leased. But as these lease renewals come up, you'll see upward pressure on office vacancy, and we've got about $1.5 trillion in commercial real estate-related debt that has to be refinanced between now and the end of 2025. Who's going to refinance that debt? And at what interest rates? Commercial real estate stands to be one of the weakest segments of the economy going forward. Now, here's the good news. I can tell you whatever story you want to hear. You want me to tell you the economy is great and go on CNN and do that? I can do that. You want me to tell you the economy is terrible and go on Fox and, you know, News and do that? I can do that. I can do whatever you'd like because I have enough data to support any story you want to hear. In fact, I want to support two stories with one data series right here. This is total non-residential construction spending. See the light in light green that ends at the top? That's total non-residential construction spending. You look at that, you say, my goodness, non-residential construction spending has taken off, Anirban. Fantastic recovery. What a period of economic growth for America. Yeah, Fantastic, except that is not adjusted for inflation. The green line at the bottom, the dark green line, is. And you look at that and say, there's, in real terms, once you adjust for inflation, no improvement there. That when people are spending more on construction services, they're not buying more construction services in the aggregate, they're just paying more for what they have been buying. The cost of living construction services has increased massively, is what I'm trying to say. Now, you say, well, Anirban, how could that be? You just showed a slide indicating that construction has added over 300,000 people since February of 2020. We've added so many construction workers, clearly output must be growing, but that does not control for productivity. And we lost a ton of very great construction workers during the pandemic to retirement. Those baby boomers who brought their A game to the job site each and every day for decades. Learned their love of working with hands and minds simultaneously in equipment early in life, often in shop class in high school. Shop class taught by someone with enormous arms wearing a Rush t-shirt driving a Trans Am. That person has been weeded out of the curriculum. We don't have enough young people entering the skilled trade, so cost goes up. You can break this down by category. Some of the weakest categories here, lodging. That's your hotel construction. This is February of 2020 versus June of 2023, the last month which we have data. We'll get the July construction spending data tomorrow, as it turns out. But lodging, that's hotel room construction. We built a ton of hotel rooms during the 5 years preceding the pandemic. Office is weak too, despite the fact that office includes data center construction. Fast, furious, frenetic. Much of NVIDIA's success as a share or a stock this year has been due to selling certain chips, GPUs as I understand it, to data processing centers, data centers. At the top of this, manufacturing, the supply chain comes back home to America. We'll talk more about that later, perhaps, if I retain some time for Q&A. Final point, materials prices. This is inputs to construction producer price index data. Materials prices are down 3.1% over the past year. That's improvement, part of this deflation or disinflationary story. Break this down by category. This is 12-month percentage change construction materials. See the headline number up above, negative 3.1%. You can see energy prices really have come down. Natural gas, crude petroleum, so on and so forth. Steel and softwood lumber also adding to those deflationary pressures. Now, that's great. That's a wonderful thing for those purchasing construction services. The issue is on the human capital side, the fact that we don't have enough skilled construction workers out there. That keeps costs high and keeps projects delayed. Okay, enough of that. Let's go to the forecast now, shall we? And then we can hopefully go to Q&A. This is a 2014 film, science fiction and orientation. In the interest of full disclosure, not my favorite Tom Cruise film, but an amazing transition slide as we go to the back end of this presentation, the forecast. So let me show you some, again, leading economic indicators. This is the Conference Board's Index of Leading Economic Indicators. This is an index that predicted the 2001 recession, predicted 07, 08, 09, and is saying, hey, this economy has some slowing to go through. I don't know, my fonts got messed up at the bottom there, but you can figure this out. We have seen this this really improve, get worse recently and improve as a forecast or predictor of recession, meaning it is becoming more aggressive in its prediction of recession going forward. We have an inventory cycle right now that is also out there. If you look at various indices of manufacturing is in its own recession. Inventories have been on the rise, whether retail inventories, wholesale merchant inventories, that's your middlemen and women, and then your manufacturing inventory. So the companies like Target, Macy's, Foot Locker have been indicating they're having difficulty, Home Depot, moving merchandise without discounting it. So the consumer's under pressure, and the retail segment increasingly is under pressure too, as along with the existing supply chain. So these measures suggest that likelihood of recession is still there. This next measure screams that recession is coming. This is your yield curve. Two lines here, the line in gold is the yield on the one-year treasury, the line in green is the yield on the 10-year treasury. Now, typically, you'd expect the yield on a 10-year treasury to be meaningfully above that on a one-year treasury. If I'm buying a 10-year U.S. treasury, I'm lending to the federal government for 10 years, I'm not going to see my principal for a decade, and therefore I'm going to demand higher interest in the interim to reward me for my patience relative to buying a one-year treasury, I'm not being as patient. But occasionally, the bond market goes topsy-turvy, upside down, inside out, Diana Ross. And the yield on the 1 year goes above the yield on the 10-year. That's an inverted yield curve. Now, these gray shaded areas are periods of recession dating back several decades. So when do you see the gold line, the yield on the 1 year, go above the green line, the yield on the 10-year, just before the 1970 recession, before 73, 74, 75, before 1980, 81, 82, before 1990, 1991, before 2001, before 07, 08, 09, not so much before 2020, that was caused by something else, but now we have massive inversion. As I got up here, the yield on the 1 year, 5.4%, the yield on the 10-year, 4.1%, 130 basis point inversion. That's been a pretty reliable predictor of recession for decades. So you know, I think recession is coming in the next 12 months, and maybe you can't handle the truth. Though you might point out to me, that's not the truth, sir, that's your forecast, and you've already admitted the economy's not worked out exactly the way you thought. Fair enough. You might also point out to me, that was not said by Tom Cruise, that was said by Jack Nicholson, 1992, A Few Good Men. Also fair point. Jack Nicholson playing the part of Colonel Nathan Jessup, and Nathan Jessup is on the stand. And he's being grilled by a young military attorney, very aggressively, very adroitly. And eventually, that line of questioning elicits that response, which is an admission of guilt. And that young attorney, Lieutenant Daniel Caffey, is played by one young and quite handsome, in my estimation, Tom Cruise. I think the economy gets worse before it gets better. The global economy is weakening. One of the reasons that oil prices have struggled, even though U.S. inventories have been falling, you know, oil inventories, for instance, is China's economic weakness, which is getting worse. You can see the announcements from Country Garden and Evergrande, so also the inability to pay debt, that real estate crisis there, really weighing down on that economy, and therefore also on commodity prices worldwide. The national economy is weakening. That's my view. Borrowing costs are higher. That's incontrovertible, and excess inflation persists. Some segments stand and hold better than others, including grocery stores and that kind of thing. And at some point, the Federal Reserve will stop raising rates, and maybe that's already happened. But it should be noted that even if they don't raise rates any further, rates are high enough to suppress economic growth. They're already restraining growth. Rates are already high enough to push us into recession. Again, monetary policy operates with long and various lags, Milton Friedman, Anna Schwartz. We've seen the impact of supply chain improvements on the economy, but not necessarily the impact of previous rate increases. That, I think, is what's going to come. And then if you get a UAW strike in September, and that is very much a possibility, watch out. This economy could die very, very quickly after Labor Day. So I think recession conditions will prevail at some point over the next 12 months. Of course, I could be wrong. I'm an economist. Thank you very much for the opportunity. It's been a privilege to be with you today. Thank you. Hopefully we have time for one or two questions.
Yeah, I think we do. So thank you very much for distilling a very complex subject with a little humor. I usually fall asleep when I look at charts from the St. Louis Fed. So we do have a couple of questions here for you. And could you start off by talking a little bit about how you think artificial intelligence or AI could impact productivity in the future?
Right. I would think that artificial intelligence will enormously boost productivity. I mean, it should be noted that it's already happening with respect to companies in travel and so on and so forth. It's, you know, I think we understand that. But this innovation is coming at a time when employers have been very dissatisfied with productivity. You know, want to get people to come back to work, they won't do it. Artificial intelligence doesn't argue. Obviously, you have to be expert in it, you know. You have to know how to prompt AI, whether it's ChatGPT or whatever. And that's the key, right? The prompts. But nonetheless, I think the productivity gains will be massive, which means that some people will be left behind, whether in financial services or other industries, because I don't need somebody to fashion my optimal portfolio anymore, my 60-40 stock bond split, for instance. AI will tell me. I don't need the professional, and that's a very highly paid professional right now. So you're going to see a lot of job loss and plentiful job gain from this, but a lot of churning in the economy.
Okay, good. Follow up a little bit of a different angle, but what are your thoughts on the impact to inflation that the Inflation Reduction Act may have?
Right. So in August of 2022, President Biden signed both the Inflation Reduction Act and the Chips and Science Act. Both of these increased federal government outlays. The University of Pennsylvania did a study on the Inflation Reduction Act and its impact on inflation and concluded that over the next few years, in fact, the Inflation Reduction Act is going to push inflation higher, all things being equal. And then starting maybe in 2026, because of the ability to negotiate drug prices, certain drug prices with certain manufacturers, maybe you've been reading about that recently, around 2026, the Inflation Reduction Act maybe starts to suppress inflation to a certain extent. But by and large, the University of Pennsylvania economists, who are very good economists, by the way, found that the Inflation Reduction Act does not reduce inflation, has very little effect on inflation, and if anything, probably raises it just a bit by increasing federal government outlays.
I think we've got time for just one more. And
it says 2 minutes and 46 seconds there.
We want a long answer here.
Okay.
So you touched on global supply chains very early in your talk. Can you explain to us a little bit further about, do you think the global supply chain has recovered? How much longer will it take to recover if it hasn't? Can you describe that a little bit further?
Well, yes. I mean, it has not fully recovered. Now, if you look at the data regarding supply chain efficiency, delivery times, lead times, this kind of thing, the worst appears to have been in late 2021, according to the macroeconomic data. People's experience may have varied, of course, in the audience, but late 2021. You still hear stories out there. I spoke to a group of mechanical contractors recently out of Texas, and they said that their lead time for generators was something like 25 weeks, their lead time for switchgear, meaning for electrical equipment, something like 25 weeks. But I had spoken 3 months earlier to a group similarly situated mechanical contractors out of Washington, D.C. At that time, they told me their lead time for switchgear was 50 weeks, and their lead time for generators was something similar to that. In some cases, lead time for switchgear was 100 weeks. So the supply chain is still improving, but also it's peripatetic, meaning it's on the move. That, you know, for four decades, roughly, the mantra was, if you want something sourced as efficiently and cheaply as possible, you produce it in China. That's completely reversed itself, with many American manufacturers saying, now China is uninvestable. That production is coming back to North America. So when supply chains are on the move, obviously that adds to cost, delays, so on and so forth. But at some point, we produce more semiconductors here. $250 billion in semiconductor manufacturing plants are in development in this country. $40 billion in battery manufacturing plants. That's new. That's different. We thought manufacturing was gone from these shores. Now it's coming back aggressively. So what can I tell you? Supply chain is not just healing, that healing process continues, but it's shifting. And that might really be the source of delay right now in terms of delivery times or lead times, is that sort of the transition that's taking place in global supply chains.
All right, good. So I think we've got about 30 seconds, so this 42. Is an interesting question. If consumers are spending heavily, is that a sign that they have given up on saving and investing?
Right. So this is a great question. In fact, this morning we received data on U.S. savings rate, which is down to 3.5%. And what that suggests is that many consumers are just overdoing it. And I think what's happened in many cases is that many American consumers want to retain the living standards, the spending standards that they enjoyed during the pandemic, when they had all these excess savings and getting stimulus payments from the government, so on and so forth. Can't do it. We've seen wage growth really soften. We've seen fewer Americans quitting their jobs because they realize now job security matters more. And so you put all that together, you cannot have a recession without the consumer participating. There's 70% of aggregate demand. Can't do it. I think post-Labor Day, you're going to start to see consumers really pull back. Might see some burst during the holiday shopping, October, November, but then thereafter, I think the consumer really gives way, and that's why I say recession's coming in the next 12 months. Again, I could be wrong, and many economists, like, again, the economists at Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, Bank of America, are saying no recession's coming. Who would you believe, me, a guy from Baltimore, or them? I'd go with them, frankly. I'd go with them. They're, you know. But the leading indicators I look at suggest the consumer is going to be increasingly under pressure.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Basu. It's been very nice.
Thanks a lot. Thanks. Thank you.